So, all right. So, are we all right, me and you?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
You mean personally?
Yeah.
Well, you know, we were under development, I think.
I don't know what the fuck is wrong with me.
Well, I mean, you're the way I... You're one of the old people I've known longer than most anybody.
I know. I was thinking about it, and I get real emotional about it because, like, I realize that I've been pestering you, and of course, you know me, like, because you didn't do the interview.
Yeah.
There was some process in my mind that eventually became, all right, if he's not going to fucking answer my emails, you know, this I understand what he's doing to me.
Yeah.
So I've got to sit down and say, wait, he's more busy than anybody I know.
Yeah.
He doesn't have time to deal with me.
Well, there's a couple of things going on when I don't answer your emails.
Yeah.
I don't answer a lot of emails if I don't have something constructive to say.
Right.
You know what I
mean?
Yeah. I just don't.
Yeah.
Because I am busy. I got the kids and work and stuff.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
also
yeah.
My mind is just clouded. So there's a lot of emails I just ignore.
Right.
Because I don't have a really good answer.
Right, right.
I'm ambivalent or...
I can't... You don't want to get into a dialogue of maybe.
Yeah, and I just don't... I can't make myself answer emails. I also have a weird thing that I've noticed recently that if somebody emails me, I don't want to answer them right away. Because I don't want to start talking to them.
That's what I mean, yeah. You don't want to get into a dialogue, yeah.
Yeah, so you know that if you answer right away, they know you just got it, and they know you're alive.
Yeah.
So they start talking to you.
Yeah.
So I go, okay, I'll wait, I'll answer this guy in like a couple hours, and then I forget. That happens more often than not. But also, you know, our friendship faded away at some point, and I had time when I was writing you emails to connect with you personally.
Yeah.
And you were ignored me.
Really?
Yeah, for a long time. For, I don't know, over a year.
Really?
Longer than that, yeah. You just wouldn't answer me, and I would write emails that said, I'm not sure why you're not writing me back, but I'm going to persist because our friendship goes back far enough.
Right, I remember that.
Saving.
Yeah.
You just wouldn't answer me.
What the fuck was my problem?
At some point, I caught you on the phone, and you said that you felt like when we talk, it's just about me, and I don't really listen to you, that I'm very self-centered.
Right.
And I took that to heart, but... I also thought, well, I felt like it was unfair. And so when I tried, and after that, I tried still to pursue you. You didn't want to talk to me. So in this round, when you were trying to get me to be on your podcast, or you're trying to connect with me, part of me was going, you know, fuck him. I don't, you know, if he doesn't want to be my friend, I'm not going to.
But we had the conversation. We made up.
Yeah, but it didn't make us start connecting.
It didn't. Was he planned to start connecting? But then you got very busy.
So.
You got very busy.
Yeah, I would say that. And look, this is yours to edit. You put in what you want here, so I'm just.
I don't care. No, but I what happens to me is that my friendship with you, like for some reason over the years, you know, despite however much distance or whether or not we see each other, whatever our lives has happened, I feel very close to you as a friend.
Yeah, no, that's the way I've always
You know, felt. And it, you know, I get choked up about it. And like, I remember like, you know, even like after, we don't talk that much, but for some reason we connect, you know, as friends pretty deeply. And then, like when you were having trouble and your marriage was coming apart, you know, there was this point where like, you know, when I finally sort of said, well, what's going on? Like, I had this idea of your life in my head. It was a lesson to be learned. Like, you know, like I know Louis from then and, you know, I know her. I was at their wedding, whatever.
Yeah.
So I had this whole idea of how your life had transpired and what was going on in your life. And I hadn't really been in touch with you at all. And then when he told me what was really going on, I was like, holy shit, how did I miss your entire life?
Yeah, sure.
And then I started to realize, because this happens a lot on the podcast, that we all know each other in a very sort of intimate, deep way because of what we do and because we are of the common ilk of comic is a comic. And there is a weird emotional understanding that we all have.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't know each other's fucking life. And then I got very saddened by the fact that I'd been out of your life and there was no way for us to keep in touch. And then, I don't know, something, resentment happened. Who the fuck knows?
Yeah.
But I think that it's sometimes when we're, you know, when you just, when you don't see someone a lot, you just sort of hold them to who they were when you did know them really well. Like, you know, that guy must be the same guy.
Yeah, I think that's true. And, I mean, we started out together, so...
We did in a weird way, because I was thinking the first time I ever saw you, period, I was in Boston, probably 1986.
Yeah.
I was living in Los Angeles and doing all those drugs, and I was sitting at Played Against Sam's with Kevin Knox.
Wow.
At, you know, upstairs. Yeah. And you were like darting around. You just had all your hair and it was red and you were skinny.
I was about 18, 19 years old.
Right. And I said to Kevin, I said, who's that guy? And he goes, that's some kid. He's some kiddie hanging around.
Yeah, he didn't know I was a comic even.
Yeah, you're just some kid.
I wasn't really. But no, the first time I saw you was at Catch. And
in Boston.
In Boston, yeah.
But like you didn't know me. I didn't know you then. But I remember.
I didn't know you and I didn't like you on stage the first time I saw you.
Yeah.
You were very aggressive.
Yeah.
And you were also in a lot of turmoil. I think you were just coming out of all this sort of Sam Kinison coke business.
So you were very,
you exuded a huge amount of insecurity and craziness.
Undisciplined, though.
Yeah.
Like I didn't think I was.
You made me uncomfortable. And then I met you, and then David Cross, I think, said, I'm going to hang out with this guy. You want to come with me? And he told me it was you, and I was like, oh, that guy. So then we went to the Coffee Connection.
Where I worked. Where
you were working, which is now Starbucks. And you were washing dishes. It was like a bad movie. Like, it was a pile of fucking cups and saucers, and you're washing them with a big, you know, hang over the sink spigot. And you had an apron on, and you were miserable. Like, you were really working hard, and you were. It was a very humbling moment in your life. And you were like, oh, you guys, I got a break in a few minutes, so you want to hang out? And I immediately liked you.
Because of that
humbling moment made me like you a lot. And it was interesting to watch you go from being this kind of L.A., long hair, Kinison pack, coked up guy.
Yeah.
You broke that. I watched you break that down. And I watched you start talking about who you were instead of doing your bits as that guy. I started watching you humiliate yourself more on stage, which is a good thing. I mean, in a good way. You had a huge humility wave that started coming in. And I've always, I think that's always been your progress has been like, taking away more and more layers, taking away more of your defenses away from yourself.
Not without a fight.
No, but the fight is fun to watch.
Ugh. Yeah, I think when I met you, the first time I knew who you were, what I remember, because when I'm sitting there trying to think about how am I going to talk to you without getting emotional and also cover, you know, the great things you're doing now, without getting emotional or resentful or crazy, the first time I had any idea of really who you were, I went to pick up Grant Taylor at the house you were living in with him.
He was my roommate, yeah.
And I went to pick him up to go to a one-nighter.
Mm-hmm.
I walked into the house, and he's getting ready to go, and there's a room. And the door is open, and there's just a light. There's a mattress on the floor, and there's just food and clothing and piles everywhere.
Disgusting. I lived in a disgusting room.
Well, that's all I saw there, and I go, who lives in there? He goes, oh, that's Louie. and that was who you were in my head. That's Louie, and you sort of remained that guy for a while, no matter how nice the apartment was.
Yes.
That was the amazing. There are certain things I remember very definitely.
Yeah.
Like, I remember the apartment. It all revolves around the apartments. I remember the apartment over the Village Gate in the atrium.
Oh, God, yeah.
Right? And, like, going over to that apartment at some point, I think you had torn a hole in the wall.
Yeah.
There were things written. You had a set list on the wall.
I used the wall of my apartment as a phone book. Like, I wrote all my phone numbers and stuff and dates.
But in big, like, indelible
Sharpie.
Ink.
Yes.
And then again, there were the clothes all over.
No, and also I remember there was one detail of that apartment on Bleecker Street was that I dropped a bottle of hot sauce one day, like a bottle of Tabasco, and it shattered on the floor.
Yeah.
And it stayed there for the entire time I lived there. But I never cleaned it. I never cleaned up the glass.
Yeah.
It was just an area of my apartment I didn't go near after a while.
But this sort of, there's something weird about that whole thing that defined you. Even when you got the nicer apartment in Chelsea.
Yeah, on 22nd Street.
Right, there was a couple of, like, I think defining moments outside of, like, and you had that Murphy bed in Bleecker Street.
Yeah.
That thing that flipped down.
It's disgusting.
The whole thing was fucking disgusting.
Yeah, it was really gross.
I just remember that you were this guy that, you know, came from where you did. You didn't go to college. You're from Newton. And you started out really young, and you were, like, building your brain.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, that you had this weird hunk. Like, I remember, like, everything. You don't know that I was with you in a couple of severely life-changing moments. I was with you when we went to fucking Blockbuster, and you got that copy
Putney Swope.
Of Putney Swope.
Yeah.
It was in a bargain bin.
That's really funny that you tell me that, because I remember it. Yeah, because I just bought a VCR for the first time.
Right, and we were just going to rent a movie.
I can't rent movies because I didn't have a credit card at the time.
So you bought them.
I bought, and it was the only thing that was for sale that wasn't like a Barney video or something.
And I remember you didn't know what it was.
No idea.
I didn't know what the fuck it was, and it changed your entire perception of movie making.
Yeah, it did. Putney Swope by Robert Downey. It just made me think you can do anything you want, even if it doesn't make any sense.
Right.
What I didn't understand was that just because Putney Swope existed in a shrink wrap box, it doesn't mean that you can go do that.
Right.
I mean, I just thought any movie that was got made and that has a package is like a lamp in the distance.
Yeah,
I can do that too.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's not okay.
But I'm
really glad that was my first big inspiration.
Isn't that weird, though?
Yeah, you were there. It's funny because I was telling somebody this story recently about getting Putney Swope.
Yeah.
And you didn't remember me. You were there.
There's another thing I think you told that you forgot I was there that was another amazing day, is when we found that computer on the street.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you remember that was me, too?
I told that story on stage in Nashville recently.
Really?
Yeah.
How did that end?
First time I ever...
Well, that was there were two things I learned about you that day. We found this fucking computer on the street. It was right by the Chelsea
place. Somebody threw it in the garbage. Yeah,
it was an old shitty computer.
Yeah,
and we took it into your apartment, and then like all of a sudden you became this computer wizard.
And I opened it up and I fixed it.
How the fuck did you know that stuff?
Because I took AV repair in junior high school. I took a class that seemed so dry and boring.
But you knew how to do DOS and shit. Right.
Yeah, I knew how to do. My mother was a computer programmer. She is a computer programmer.
Yeah.
My mother's a software engineer, and she's had computers in our house before anyone had computers in their house.
Yeah.
We had that kind of modem where you put the phone into this big rubber cradle thing, and she had computers that had punch cards. I mean, that's how far she goes back. So I've always known computers, but I've also always known how to repair electronics. Because the class I took in junior high school.
And we hooked it up and we started getting information.
Started learning about this guy's life.
Right, and it was weird, right? He was sexually confused.
He was a gay guy who had come from somewhere in the South, like one of these places where you can't live as a gay person.
Yeah.
Been ostracized from his family because he was gay. But also when he hit New York, he started doing drugs and became a credit addict. He started buying things at Saks with his parents' credit cards.
Right.
And then he went home and he stole his parents' like retirement bonds.
And he was writing this in a diary? How do we know
he
all
was,
this?
Well, the thing is, I've never... This is the amazing thing about looking at somebody's computer. And I have some grief about it because it wasn't nice to do that to this person. But, you know, at least I didn't tell anybody in his life.
Yeah.
I just carry his information in my head. But
we called him.
We saw his... Did we call him?
Yeah, just to see if he was
remember
a real
doing
guy.
That.
Yeah, no, we didn't say anything. But
we just called him. We heard his voice.
Yeah.
I don't remember that. Well, no, the thing was that we found his lies because we saw what he wrote to different people. There wasn't email
right.
then.
That's right.
There wasn't email
right.
then.
Right, it was letters.
That's how crazy... We read letters that he wrote to different people in a play he had written.
Yeah.
That told we saw what his lies were.
Yeah, yeah.
But he went to a bunch of the story we pieced together because he wrote his family's lawyer, who was the only connection he had to his parents because they wouldn't speak to him.
Right.
He took all of his parents' money and spent it on crap and drugs.
Yeah.
And his father had to come out of retirement. His father had to stop being retired and go back to like a shit job because he destroyed his parents'. Elderly lives.
I don't see so you. And you sat with the info. I didn't know all of this.
He wrote to the family lawyer saying, "Please get my dad to speak to me because it was hard enough on him that I'm gay, but also now I've destroyed his life. But he really, you know, he's kind of an asshole too, or whatever." And then he'd write somebody else mean things about his parents that didn't represent.
How
the
did
truth.
You represent this as a story? What was the arc? Where did this go?
I started talking on stage at Nashville, well, because right now I'm trying to come up with a new material, so I'll talk about anything on stage. I think it died in the middle of the story.
Yeah.
But it was fascinating to people. When you tell people something like that, I found a computer that was broken, and I turned it on and started learning about the person.
Yeah.
People start really fucking listening. And that guy did have an interesting life from what I knew of it, but...
Yeah. I just remember that event, and I remember that.
Well, the part of it that would turn into a really interesting hook on stage was the idea that he was complaining about his father's homophobia to his friends.
Yeah.
And saying, "My parents hate me because I'm homophobic, but I know the truth. I think only I know the truth about this guy."
Yeah. Yeah.
That he was. His parents hated him because he destroyed their lives because of his fucking credit problems and because of his drug addiction. but he called it, oh, they're just homophobic from the South.
Right.
And it was an interesting insight to me, and it made me wonder about other people who, like, you ever watch The Sopranos?
Yeah.
There was some storyline where Meadow had a black boyfriend.
Yeah.
And her father was racist against him. He didn't like her having a mixed, being in a mixed couple. And then the boyfriend turned out to just be a prick.
Right.
And he left her.
Yeah.
Because he's an asshole.
Right.
And her mother said, whatever happened to him, and she, you see her wheel spin, and then she goes, daddy chased him off. And it's bullshit. She lost him partly because he's an asshole, but also because she was superficially didn't like her.
Yeah.
Yeah. But she wasn't going to let go of her right.
Right.
To say, my daddy's a racist piece of shit, even though it didn't have anything. And I wonder how much that happens in, like, people that complain about racism or homophobia in their lives or any discrimination.
A lack of taking responsibility for their own real feelings.
That they have something that they've done, that they use it to cover stuff in their lives.
Well, I talk about being in Scotland where I say, you know, fuck the Scottish.
Yeah, no, that's what
And because they didn't like me.
Exactly.
So, and that enables me to generalize about an entire culture of people. Like, yes, those Scots didn't like, but I'm aware that it was that personal.
Exactly.
And that I don't know anything about Scottish history.
Every time I go to England, it's a challenge. I love working there, and I often have some great shows there, but sometimes I don't. It's, to me, the hardest place for me to work. And I know it's all about me. I go there with all kind of preconceived shit.
Yeah.
Whenever I come home from being in England, every show I do, I say, fuck the fucking dirty British, and I just say terrible things about them, because I know, first of all, the people here will just get excited. I don't care what crowd, we're still America, and they're still England.
Fuck anything is good here.
Oh, yeah.
As long as we don't acknowledge it, we're in trouble.
No.
Yeah. And I think the other, I think, defining thing, and not so much that I was a defining thing, I'm just trying to remember when I was sitting there, like, I was surprised by how much I know about your career without actually researching it, just because I knew you. There were times where I'd go to your house and you had all big wads of money, because you came down here in probably, what, 1988?
88, 89, yeah.
And you and Nick DiPaolo, who you've known together for years, and people see him on the show, you lived together in that fucked up apartment.
Yes.
That Barry Katz owned.
Barry Katz's apartment. Barry Katz, who's, he created Last Comic Standing, right?
He's Dane Cook's manager. He's Whitney Cummings' manager. Yes. I think he's still Jay Moore's manager.
Anthony Clark, all those people.
Yeah, I mean, he used to run a comedy operation out of a basement in Alston, Massachusetts. Yes. And there was a period in time where he just said, I'm going to sign everybody.
Yeah,
and
I was his first client. I was his first client. And I was also the first person to fire him.
Yeah.
But anyway, Barry had an apartment on 82nd Street in Central Park West, a little tiny studio.
Right.
With, like, one of those, like, a stove that looks like it's a dollhouse, like it's a joke.
Yeah.
And it had a loft.
So yes.
It had a bed up on this rickety loft and a bed underneath it.
Yeah.
And he charged comedians from Boston $150 each per month to have a right to use this apartment.
How many were there?
There was, like, 15 guys. And it was a terrible combination of guys. Anthony Clark was one of them.
Yeah.
Ed Regine, the guy from Providence.
No. The guy who was put in jail for turning back odometers.
Yes. And Wally Collins was one of them. Anyway, Nick and I went down there a lot.
Yeah.
And then Barry he was giving up, the lease came up.
Yeah.
And he didn't want to do it anymore. I don't think he was making enough profit. He was trying to make a profit.
Sure.
And he wasn't making enough, so he was giving it up.
Yeah.
And Nick and I contacted the landowner, landlord, and we got the place.
Right, and then you and Nick were working at Catch a Rising Star, and I was wandering through the streets with Todd Berry, wondering why we couldn't work at Catch a Rising Star. Yeah. And I just remember you taking out of your pocket wads of cash after an evening at work.
Yeah,
and I was just sort of like, fuck. But he's doing that to hate me.
So you used, that was a cash business then, and you'd get $50 a show, and there was that one really heightened time in the late 80s.
Yeah, where it's just money.
You could do 10 sets a night.
That's right.
And they were $50 each, and I had a motorcycle then.
Oh, yeah, the fucking motorcycle.
I had a Honda Super Sport 750.
And that was that time where you used to run up and down the west of FDR, and you wrecked it.
I used to go on the FDR doing, like, literally 100 miles an hour so I could get to shows quicker, and I'd do, like, you know, two shows at the Boston Comedy Club.
Yeah.
One at the Cellar, one at the Village Gate, or two at the Village Gate. And then I'd run screaming uptown to do the catch and the comic strip.
Didn't you wreck that fucker?
Show. Yes. What,
you laid it down. It freaked you out. You somehow walked away from it.
Yeah, it was a weird turning point in my life because that was... I remember one day... It's just funny because you mentioned the pockets full of cash.
Yeah.
I remember one night I'd done like 10 shows.
Yeah.
And I was 23 years old, something like that. 20, not even... like yeah, like 22 years old.
Yeah.
And I parked my bike at my garage in the Village.
Yeah.
And I had... my pockets were bulging with cash that I had made. And I mean, you know, $50 a show, 10 shows. So what's that? That's $500?
Yeah.
$500 for a night's work.
Right.
23 years old. And then I'm walking to my Bleecker Street Village apartment.
Yeah, you used to park, yeah, I remember you had the parking space across the way. It was a walk.
Yeah.
And you also had cars there, too. Didn't you have, yeah, you bought these weird muscle cars. There was,
but so when I remember this one specific night that I was walking home with a ton of cash from my motorcycle to my Village apartment. And I thought, I have the greatest life in the world.
Yeah.
I don't even care if I don't become famous or anything. This is the balls.
Yeah.
I have the world by the fucking balls. I had that thought that night.
Yeah.
And then the next night, I was going down Second Avenue doing about 70 miles an hour, and a car went through a red light going perpendicular. And I never even touched my brakes. I just plowed right into this car.
And he flew over it.
I flew over the car. I lost my sight, but I was still cognizant, I remember. Yeah. And the bike was in pieces. I came sort of, my sight came back, and the bike was in pieces in front of me. I heard a woman scream. It was a nightmare. And I got strapped to a board and taken to a hospital. And after lots of CAT scans and tests and shit, this doctor came into my, you know, to me in the hallway of, you don't have a room.
Yeah.
And he said, "You're fine. You're stupid. Don't ride motorcycles anymore, but you're fine." And he said, "Take it easy for a while." And so I hopped off of this table, and I thought, I'm just going to go home. But, you know, the threshold to which you need to be hospitalized is still pretty, like, you still pretty badly. I really fucked myself up, and I could barely walk. I mean, I was in really bad, but I hadn't broken anything.
So everything was sore.
My whole body had bruises all over the side of it that grew as the weeks went by. Like, for 2 weeks, I was, like, in bed.
Like on your hip and shit?
Yeah, on my leg, and I was fucking wreck, and my motorcycle was gone.
Yeah.
And I slept that night, and I just felt really terrible. I think I'd peed myself. Like, it was just really bad, humiliating experience. And then I looked in the mirror the next day, and I was balding. I saw it for the first time.
Yeah.
That I was losing my hair.
Right.
And, like, within that week, Catch Rising Star closed. That was, remember, that was the first. Catch and the Improv went down, like, 1-2.
Mm-hmm.
They both closed. And things started getting really bad. Like, things immediately started getting bad. And then the 90s came, and all the clubs started closing.
Yeah.
And I couldn't make a living anymore, and I couldn't pay my rent. Like, that night was a huge instant turning point. Everything from that night on in my life went badly.
Yeah.
For like 3-4 years.
I've always believed that, you know, despite what you think, I think of you, that, you know, out of anybody I know, and I've always said this, that if anybody, you know, has the capacity to create, you know, some genius in this fucking game, you know, you're the guy.
Oh,
that,
thanks.
Because your work ethic is unique, and you very consciously let things get so fucking bad for yourself.
Yeah.
In order to see if you can rise from it, that you know, that's always been this weird ethic you had. That even when you were, like, I remember one time in that fucking Chelsea apartment that you were surrounded by garbage. I mean, real garbage. There was garbage bags that were not being taken out, and I said, "Why don't you take this out?" And you just said, "I just can't do it.
I couldn't do it.
And there was dishes, there was stink in there.
Yep.
And then it was right around the same period where you shit yourself on purpose.
I don't think I ever really did that.
Oh, you
don't? I used to do a joke about that, but I don't think I ever really did that.
Okay.
I used to think about it, like just shitting my pants and then cleaning it up and just chalking it up to experience.
Yeah. Right. But there was all this.
I don't think I ever did that.
Okay. All right.
I don't think so. I might have. I don't know.
But when was the transition? Now, I guess at that time when all the crap started hitting the fan, you got your first writing job, writing for Jon Stewart when he hosted the Carolines. Was that it? Was that the first writing job?
Colin Quinn hosted Carolines Comedy Hour. Jon Stewart was the head writer.
And you were the writing for
me
that?
Me and David Tell and Susie Essman were the writing staff.
And that started your writing career?
Yeah, that was the first, like, writing job I had,
And then you went from there to Conan after a period of time.
Yep.
Because I think that's important, especially because a lot of comedians listen to this and a lot of people that are interested in comedy listen to it, that the thing that makes you that thing that evolved you into the great, auteur that you are now and personal comedian was that you were one of these guys, like, in my world, like, after a certain point, me being jealous of you, it serves no purpose, because, and people don't realize this when they listen to this, is that, your automatic feeling is, like, I'm a comedian, that guy's a comedian, why the fuck does he get that?
Right.
That people don't realize it, and then at a certain point you're like, well, because I can't do what that guy does, or I'm not doing what that guy does.
It's just he's playing a different instrument, that's all. Yeah.
But because we're all comics, you think, who gave them that?
Right.
And the thing was is that you could write and produce television and do stand-up, and you were making short films at the time, all at the same time.
Yes.
But what's happened now, and we can talk about it because it's interesting, because your evolution from what was basically an absurdist point of view, that when you started and all the way up to probably, not that long ago, your jokes were really, about ridiculous,
silly thing.
Poetry.
Yeah.
They were crass and some of them were deep, but they were still not invested in your life.
Absolutely true. Yeah,
and at some point that turned because I think your anger got to a level where you thought you were denying yourself.
Yeah,
by not engaging in your life.
Yeah, definitely.
Now, so you were one of the original crew on the first Conan. You defined the original Conan O'Brien show with Dino and with Robert.
Yeah, Robert Smigel was the head writer, and that was what stopped the slide for me, because after that motorcycle accident, I just kept losing money and opportunities. And I remember I called you. It's funny when you're talking about things that you were there for, because you had moved to San Francisco.
Right.
You had this forward thinking of, like, I want to actually live like a human being, and I don't want to live in this place where if I can't get two shows in a week, I'm literally starving to death.
Yeah.
So you moved to San Francisco, and we're living like a person. And I had visited you out there, and I loved the life you had. And then I went back to New York, and I was doing Tony Camacho gigs.
But wait. Can I just put something in real quick?
Yeah.
That you went to San Francisco, I think, and this is who Louis is. I think you bought a car off a comic. Didn't you?
I went to L.A., and I bought, because I was going to do L.A., and then I was going to do San Francisco. I bought a 68 Mustang.
But this was just a road trip, and you bought a car.
I bought a car. But you know what? I don't regret that, because...
No, it's not a matter of regret. It's just who you
are.
I
couldn't rent cars, because I couldn't get credit. For years.
Yeah.
Because I couldn't pull my life together.
So you bought
to
a car
credit.
With
a...
Did you
I
buy
bought
a car?
It cost me $1,100. It was a black 68 Mustang.
But didn't you lose
car.
Your credit because you bought a car with your Amex?
Yes, that's why I lost my credit, because I bought a BMW with an American Express card. And I had to give the car back, and everybody that was involved with it, the car dealer and Amex, were like, we're going to let you out of this, but you're never going to get a credit card again.
Right.
It took me... Well, I finally got a credit card by getting one of those credit cards that you just pay money for.
I remember that.
And it rehabilitated me. It took me years to get a credit card.
And the other thing you did was you were locked out of your apartment once, so you got a room at the Ritz? Or something like that?
I used my Amex... When I got an Amex card, I just became an idiot. Yeah, I couldn't get into my apartment, so I got a room at the Ritz-Carlton in Central Park.
Yeah.
And I stayed there for like 3 nights. And Amex isn't a credit card, It's you got to pay every month.
Yeah, I know.
So I just couldn't... Yeah. There was 1 month that I just went, I bought a BMW, I stayed at the Ritz, and then...
That was it?
Yeah, and I was also on an installment plan with Amex for years to pay that back. I have an Amex card now, I don't know how they don't remember, but
you bought the Mustang for $1,100.
$1,100, and then I drove from L.A. to San Francisco. I was with a girl who wasn't fucking me, but she wanted to go camping with me. And she and I ran and camped. We bought two pup tents and we drove around in a Mustang and went camping in like the Great Grand Canyon in fucking Utah. And it was a tremendous trip.
But you guys were at each other's throats, right?
We hated each other. When we got to Yosemite and she was being so awful to me.
Yeah.
That I said, I'm taking you. She had somebody she was staying with in San Francisco.
Right.
And we were supposed to be there like in 5 days.
Yeah.
I said, you're going to your friend's house today. And we got in the car and we drove through Yosemite all the way to San Francisco without speaking to each other.
Oh.
And we saw like fucking bears, fighting, and we couldn't talk to each other about it. But and it's she's now. I actually got emails from her last year, and I was really happy to hear from. She was a cool person. Now,
yeah,
she
is,
kids.
Yeah.
We all have kids now, except for you. But
okay.
So, sorry. Anyway, this is your when I called you.
Yeah. At Conan.
Yeah, I wasn't doing well, and I was doing gigs in, you know, like the Nanuet Holiday Inn.
Sure.
Stuff like that.
The Taunton Regency?
Taunton Regency. Well, I'd have to go up to Boston sometimes and did those.
Yeah, that's what we did.
But
yeah.
there was the New York equivalent, which is like the Connecticut whatever.
One-nighters.
And places like Ronkonkoma Comedy Club in Long Island. I mean, just terrible, terrible. When everyone was shitting on comedy, it wasn't...
And you had to drive up to 4 or 5 hours to make $200, like $250.
$200, and I was working a lot for a guy named Tony Camacho, who one night I worked Rascals Comedy Club in New Jersey, middling for some guy for, $100 a show.
Yeah.
And at the end of the week, he paid me like $150 light of what he owed me.
Yeah.
And I said, "You owe me more." And he just laughed at me and said, "Yeah, what are you going to do about it? Come on. You need the work. What are you going to do?" And I was like, "Wow. You're just going to take my money." But he was right. I worked for him several times after that.
These guys are the gatekeepers.
No, they're amazing. So that's where I was at.
Right.
And then SNL had a huge turnover. Saturday Night Live threw out a huge amount of their cast. It was one of their biggest.
That's when I went in. Was it 95, 94?
Oh, no, this is 93.
Right.
Or summer of 93.
Right.
And everybody I knew got hired. Every single person. David Tell was a writer.
Yeah.
Jay Moore was a writer-performer. Sarah Silverman, writer-performer. Lark Keitlinger.
Yeah.
Jeanine Garofalo.
Yeah.
I mean, my entire generation of comics got hired in SNL. Everybody.
Yeah.
And I was at the same audition. I auditioned the same night. And I remember I was on first. They put me on fucking first. And Jon Stewart was hosting.
Right.
And Louis Ferranda, who ran the club then, the SNL people hadn't shown up. So
right.
I said, "I just want to start. Let's get going." And he told me to go on without them being there.
Yeah.
And I said, "But they're not going to see me." And he said, "We got to get going. I don't care." And I mean, I was crushed that I was just not going to get seen.
The gatekeepers, again.
Yeah. So Jon Stewart was my friend, and he said, "I'll do as long as I can."
Yeah.
And he did like 20 minutes to open, but then he kind of shrugged at me and said, "I got to bring you up." And I went on, and the instant I went on, the SNL people came in. And not only did they come in at a bad time, they also fucked up my set because they were
huge.
It was like 12 people.
Yeah.
But saving grace was that David Spade was in the group, and he knew me. I didn't know him personally, but he liked my act, so he told him, "Sit down and watch this guy." And I saw him do it, and I had a great set. And then everybody else followed, and the next day, everybody found out who was hired. Everybody was hired, and I wasn't. And then I thought, this is it. I mean, I don't know if I can keep doing this.
And that's when you called me?
I called you in the middle of the night to ask you about San Francisco and whether I should move there. And I was questioning the whole career.
Yeah. And did I say anything helpful?
We talked for till dawn.
Yeah.
And I think I unloaded on you that I didn't think I had any shot at anything anymore and that I was really remorseful. But it's like coming out of prison. How do you back out of a comedy career?
Yeah.
I was 25 years old. And I had been doing stand-up since I was 18.
Yeah.
So I had no way.
No skills. No.
Nothing to offer.
Except you could resurrect a dead computer.
Yeah, I could fix a computer or a car. Or I could cover a football game for a cable station, you know? And so we talked about it. You told me about your life there. And I just thought, I'm not going to make it there either. And I hung up the phone intensely depressed.
Yeah.
And then my phone rang like 2 hours later. Like I got 2 hours sleep and it was... this guy, "Hi, my name is Robert Smigel. I don't know if you've heard about the Letterman show going away, and Conan is this guy." And I didn't know any idea who Conan was. And he said, "Jim Downey saw you at Catch." Jim Downey was running SNL then. And he said that you were funny, so I wanted to know if you had any writing samples.
Did you?
I had it. Well, I had short films I had made.
You had, the ones
that
with
I just
Shapiro
made on my own dime.
And Ice Cream.
Yeah, all that kind of
That's
stuff.
That's available still on DVD, right?
No, but you can see it on YouTube. I just put it all on YouTube.
Oh, you don't sell that DVD of the short films?
No, because I had to just make that in my house, that DVD.
I have one of those. Maybe I should hold on to it.
Sell it, yeah. But
or maybe I think my ex-wife actually took that. She's a big fan.
Oh, okay, good. Well, she could sell it then. Which ex-wife?
Oh, Mishina.
Okay. But anyway, yeah, he hired me. Within a week, I was hired at Conan. They saved my fucking life.
And I think it's important for people who are listening to realize that, you know, between you, Robert Smigel, Dino Staffan, what I can never
remember. Stamatopoulos.
Stamatopoulos and Conan.
Yeah.
You guys redefined, you know, what late night sketch comedy looked like in the context of that type of show.
Yeah, it was a pretty different show, yeah.
Well, you were pushing the envelope because your comedy, being as absurd as it was, and his sensibility and Dino's sensibility, you know, brought this type of, you know, almost childlike inventiveness to sketch comedy again, which was completely unique.
I think that's true, yeah.
And that it set the tone for that show for the next 12 years.
Yep.
And you remain friends with Smigel and Dino, I guess.
Yeah,
To some degree. But, I mean, it's just interesting that you were at these junctures where the one thing I also remember is that coming off of that, and this is still when your stand-up is primarily, you know, absurd, but, you know, but inspired, but, you know, noise-based and a lot of,
yeah.
Right? I mean, I'm not being condescending.
No, not at all. Of course not.
But the greatest moment of this type of style backfiring, which I thought was an important moment, was when Dana Carvey got the variety show.
Yeah.
And Smigel was the head writer, and he brought you guys in.
Yep.
And you wrote that sketch, that opening piece.
The nipples thing, yeah.
That really was like a thing where, like, it sort of resonates all the way through to Conan, you know, not, you know, functioning the way the network wanted to in the Tonight Show slot.
Right.
Was that, you know, here Dana Carvey had a primetime show, and he brought in you guys who were a late night operation.
Yep.
And you guys struggled over that sketch. And what was it again?
It was just this weird idea that I had on the way to work one morning that Bill Clinton would had surgery so that he had nipples going down so that he could breastfeed. The first idea was just that he could breastfeed.
Right.
And then I thought then he would have nipples going down his belly and like a puppy, like a dog.
Yeah.
And
you had to work around Carvey, who was an impressionist.
Yeah.
That's who
I think
you were
that's why
for.
I said Bill Clinton.
Right, right, know. Of course.
But I also did like the idea of Bill Clinton breastfeeding a baby.
Right.
Like on national TV to
right.
show that he was a nurturing
right. So it was
president.
A good-hearted idea, but it was an opening sketch for the first show, was it not?
Yeah, and it didn't. It shouldn't have been. I mean, it was. I argued against it being the opening sketch because I thought it's going to kill us. But the network really wanted Dana to do an in-one. It was like just this thing where they wanted a thing where Dana, in a character, talks to a camera, and it's the only option we gave them that had that.
The only option you gave him was that Bill Clinton
yes,
opens
exactly.
his shirt. He has puppy nipples. He has dog nipples.
Yeah,
like a
and there's milk spurting out of them onto live puppies and squirting them in the face and kittens on his desk.
And what was the blowback from
really
that?
Really scared the shit out of people. It really bummed people out. Because we were on right after Tim Allen's show. We were on it. We were not a late night show.
Yeah.
We were on it fucking 8:30.
Yeah.
Is or that 8 o'clock. I think we were on like it was something crazy. Like, what are you doing?
Mm-hmm.
And I learned a lot from that whole experience. It was a terrible, terrible experience. I hated it. I hated being
What did you
show.
Learn?
I just learned that you can't force people to like something if it's not what they want. I mean, it's not. Why were we trying to make these people? We would get these letters that were heartbreaking. You know,
really?
That really hurt my feelings. Like people that are really like just were so upset by what we did.
But but in that sense, though, like you and Dino and Robert, you know, though Robert is he's a little more cartoon thinking. But
yeah.
I mean, wasn't that part of the agenda? Was it to push the envelope?
Well, when we did the show, ABC had NYPD Blue on the air.
Yeah,
and they had created something new in television, which was a watershed hour. That, you know, in British television, they have a watershed hour.
Right.
After a certain hour, you can do absolutely anything you want. Nudity,
right.
Doesn't matter. Because they just figure kids have gone to sleep. That's how they handle it.
Yeah.
If you're dirty, you go after watershed. Well, ABC started saying words like shit and asshole on NYPD Blue. That was brand new.
Yeah.
So I think actually we were on like, honestly, I think we were on like 9 o'clock because we were right before NYPD Blue.
Right.
And so that's what they said. You're the first show before that time, so you can be really edgy. We want you to get in trouble. We
right.
want you to make waves. That's what they told us.
The wrong group of guys to do that.
So we came on. I was actually the head writer, and Robert was the executive producer. He wanted to make me head writer because he wanted to be on. He was in the cast. He wanted to be able to do both. And but then after we signed, during the summer that we developed the show, ABC was sold to Disney. That's when that happened.
Right.
ABC was bought by Disney. And so we all of a sudden, everything changed.
Yeah.
And they said, they stopped saying you're on before NYPD Blue. They started saying you're on right after Tim Allen. That became the focus of the show.
Right.
And they put Dana on a huge two-page ad in TV Guide with his arm around Kermit the Frog.
Oh, my God.
A picture he never posed for.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And he was furious.
Yeah.
And the expectation for the show was it's going to be very sweet. And Dana's a sweet guy. He's not a guy you think of as irreverent.
Well,
he's
when you were really trying to sell guy. Him on the breastfeeding thing, what was that like?
He loved it. I mean, Dana was a gamer. I loved him.
Yeah.
Dana's a great guy. And he's an enormously talented, just funny actor. And he's got old chops. He's a real traditional. He's like Sid Caesar or something.
Right.
I thought the show had great potential because of what he could do and what he was willing to do.
Yeah.
He was willing to do anything.
Right. I think, okay, so now if we move into like the other stuff, I think one of the other turning points, you have this uncanny ability to really hold on to small bits of wisdom that sort of define your life for a while. You know, and I've noticed that, you know, people who, and this is for me included, but you also, that people whose fathers were, you know, primarily absent, tend to try to put their life together on their own.
That's a really interesting observation. I think that's true.
You know, where you're sort of scrambling for the right role models and the wisdom that's going to guide you, you know, through your creativity, through your life. Mm-hmm. Things that you can, you know, like sort of these mental marking posts of like, you know, that thing means something to me and it can help me. And I remember when Francis Ford Coppola was a guest on Conan and you guys were doing Bad Fruit Theater.
Yeah.
Which was really just small puppetry with rotten fruit, you know, from movie scenes. And you were, like, really obsessed with this. You know, we're going to do Apocalypse Now. You brought me in to do Dennis Hopper's voice.
Yeah, I remember.
And I think, like, the Dennis Hopper rotten peach, you know, fell off its thing. You know, but you were so, you so wanted Francis Ford.
Big deal for me.
Right.
Yeah.
You really wanted Coppola to acknowledge your genius for taking a scene from his movie and doing it with rotten bananas.
Yeah, that was the biggest deal in the world to me.
It was like, I remember, because you're like, this is a big opportunity, because you were a filmmaker, and I think, you know, outside of being a stand-up, once you started making films, you really saw yourself as a filmmaker.
That's what I wanted to do,
Yeah.
Because I was obsessed with Coppola, because that movie Heart of Darkness had come out,
right.
That documentary about Apocalypse Now, and that was a massive inspiration. That made me believe that I could be a filmmaker.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the way he...
How crazy he was.
And how he worked against the odds and made that happen. He made that movie happen without anyone really wanting him to.
Yeah, and he had a large enough personality and enough talent to people where people would tolerate.
Yeah, and there was a moment, and when you talk about little things that have been guiding principles for me, that one has like eight of them in him. And one of them was... this guy in the movie saying the way Francis operates is he wants to make a movie, he just starts making the movie.
Yeah.
He doesn't wait for permission or for even the money. He just starts making the movie. And he figures if I start making the movie, people start joining along. And that's how I've done everything since then. Just start making it and give it a life. You know?
Well, that always amazed me about you, and we'll come around to that in a minute, is that, you know, you wrote an entire script. You would write these scripts that were based on ideas that, like, you know, I would have the, if I had the idea, I'd be like, that's ridiculous. And you would have this ridiculous idea.
Write a movie about it,
What was that fucking script, The Beard?
Oh, Annie's Beard.
What was that about?
That was about a woman, like a pretty young woman.
Yeah.
Who works in show business. Based on Lorne Michaels' assistants. He had all these blonde assistants back then. Like a mean-spirited pretty girl.
Yeah.
Who works for a big studio mogul.
Yeah.
And drives a Jetta, you know, and whatever. And one day she's talking on the phone.
Yeah.
She's driving and she plows into a kid and kills a kid.
Yeah.
And the kid happens to be a girl who has a beard, like a full man's beard.
See, right there I would stop the movie idea.
Exactly. So she has this beard and you just see it. It's not made a big deal out of it. You just see when she sees, you see the kid get hit, the kid has a beard.
Yeah.
And... So she goes, she's vilified by the L.A. community, you know, the press.
Yeah.
Big sensational trial of the woman who killed it. Gorgeous, rich woman on a phone killing a kid. It would be, you know. So she's on trial and the kid has a little, the dead girl has a brother who says, what happens is the family of the girl is so nice and they don't want to ruin this woman's life. They don't want her to go to prison. They go to the judge and say, please don't ruin her life. We lost our little girl. We don't want her. And the judge is very moved by this. And the little boy says that he tells this story that their father had a beard.
Yeah.
And he died.
Yeah.
And that the girl willed herself to grow a beard.
Yeah.
As a monument to
him. Yeah.
And said, as long as I wear this beard, he'll never die.
Yeah.
And now she's gone.
Yeah.
So could she grow a beard? The little boy asks the judge. I can't believe I wrote this. And so the judge says, you have to get a beard put, like, really, not like a fake beard, but you have to really
grow a beard
and keep it for the 10 years you would have done in prison. And so there's this scene where they graft a beard onto her, like they do this whole crazy, this fucking insane thing, and she wears a beard. And she has a probation officer who just makes sure, like, gives it a tug and makes sure it's there always.
Yeah.
She's not allowed to obscure it, you know. Yeah. And there's a whole thing where she goes and tries to wear, like, she goes to, like, a store where they sell burqas and other Middle Eastern.
Yeah.
And learns about concealing beauty and what that means to Muslims and stuff. And it destroys her life. She can't work in television. She can't. It's a cosmetic industry.
Yeah.
So it's about her coming to terms with her life and her value as a person.
And her beard.
At one point, she shaves it and runs off, and there's, like, helicopters chasing her like The Fugitive. It's fucking crazy. But, no, it was a mess. But I was obsessed with it. I tried to get it made for, like, 3 years.
Ugh.
And it broke my heart.
That you didn't get it made?
Never made it. Never will.
And then there was I guess, you know, we should talk, you know, quickly about the Pootie Tang debacle. Because, I mean, I think a lot of people that love you, you know, look at that movie as this, you know, cult movie.
Yeah.
And I remember when you were going through that you had a very specific vision for that movie. And it was the first time you had studio backing. And then you had to go through that process where the studio, you know, gutted you, took your power away, stole your movie.
That's right. It's terrible.
I just remember that there was this point when you had your first cut and you were ready to go and they screened it. And who was the big executive? She was famous that sat there. Who?
Sherry Lansing. Sherry Lansing was running Paramount at the time.
And they sat down with that movie that you were ready, that you were done with.
Yeah.
And you were there. And what happened?
Well, I went out to L.A. for a screening. Really, John Goldwyn was the main guy that we dealt with there. He was Samuel Goldwyn's grandson, this guy.
So you, of course, attached a great legacy. Knowing you, that's sort of like you're part of movie history.
Yeah, that was a big deal. Yeah. That was a big deal to me. And I still, to me, it's like,
remind me more of John Milius, actually, than Francis Ford Coppola.
Yeah, probably with, you know. But I loved that experience, even in its worst time. I was very unhappy. It was very stressful. And there were times where it's one of those things where you're, back gets put against the wall, and then it feels like somebody's pushing on your chest, but you don't have anywhere to go. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Things got worse and worse, and I started to wonder what my capacity was.
As a filmmaker?
As a human being. I wasn't sure what my capacity was to take the stress I was taking on.
So you made this
and
cut.
And the fear that I was living
right.
with.
Right. But your vision as a filmmaker is fairly specific, and that was a fairly specific
take. Made that movie exactly the way I wanted
right.
to.
It was
and in cutting it, I found out, first of all, that I had made a flawed movie. Like, it wasn't good.
Yeah.
I didn't make a beautiful movie that Paramount destroyed. I made a flawed movie that didn't really hang together as a feature. I would, with the wisdom I have now, I would have, if I were them, just let it be released the way I made it.
Yeah.
And just see what happens. It wasn't a big risk. It was a $3 million movie.
Yeah.
And Chris Rock was in it.
Yeah.
It made its money back the first weekend. It was fine.
Yeah.
I would have just let it go because they wasted an enormous amount of money recut. They recut for almost a year. And they just poured money into it trying to make it better, and it never was going to be any better. It just got worse.
But did you get that feeling during that time? Because I remember the time where there's a story about, you know, about Ken Kesey. And One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, which was a stage play. You know, he agreed to letting them make the stage play from his book, but he did not sign off on the movie.
Right.
And there's that story where they figured out a legal loophole, and they based the movie on the stage play. And an interviewer asked Kesey, did you go see the movie? And he said, look, if a couple of Hell's Angels came to your door and knocked on your door and said, we're raping your daughter, you want to come out and watch?
Yeah.
Would you go?
No, it's a good way to put it. But I didn't think of that movie as my kid. Also, I signed on to it. When we first started talking about doing Pootie Tang, they were going to do it with Paramount Classics, which was like their little indie arm. And they were going to make it for $2 million. And I was so excited. And then they said they wanted to make it for $3 million and do it with Paramount proper and give it to John Goldwyn and make it as a real, even though it wasn't a lot of money, as a studio movie. And I said I didn't want to do it because I thought that process would destroy it. I didn't think I could work under that.
Yeah.
Not on Pootie Tang.
Right.
It's a crazy idea.
But then the interesting thing about, like, knowing how politics and show business work, which I think this was the big lesson for you, is that, you know, they then took the movie and they hired people you knew and had worked with on the Chris Rock show, which you also wrote.
That's right, and also movies on my little short movies. I had a lot of people on it. Rick Shapiro was in Pootie Tang.
Well, but
all
I mean,
these
just
guys
in
done this goofy
but,
stuff with.
Right, but in the sense that they were going to take your movie and then rewrite it and recut it.
Oh, you mean
it.
when they went to redo it?
Yeah.
They hired Ollie Leroy, who was a writer. He was one of my friends, one of the writers I worked with on Chris Rock. Yes.
Now, did that destroy relationships for you, or at some point did you
just
accept?
We're not friends now.
Oh, okay.
I hated what he did to the movie, but, you know, I don't know. His job was different than what my job was, so
right.
I look at it very differently now, but at the time I was pissed off at him.
So getting back to
the job and
for hurting
the movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So getting back to the Coppola episode of Conan, because I remember what he said to you. That, you know, out of all this expectation...
I'm more interested in what do you remember, because I wonder...
What
do you remember that happened?
Well, I remember that, you know, that you really wanted him to recognize
you.
Yeah,
I wanted to get a big ups from him.
Yeah, you know, you know, you'd done this thing with the bananas.
It took days.
Yeah, to write this scene.
Yes.
It was this scene where you're going to say he was a wise man, he was
a kind man,
yes. He had plans, he had wisdom, bullshit, man. and that you really wanted Coppola to sort of tip his hat at you for this great puppet show that you put on from his thing.
Yep.
And he sort of iced you a little bit.
I said, hey, somebody introduced us. This is Louis C.K. He's the one who created the fruit thing that you saw that you just watched.
Yeah.
And Coppola smiled tightly and went, it's very nice, thanks.
But then the thing that he said to you was, do you have kids?
No, I don't remember that. Tell me what that is. I don't remember that.
You know, he asked you if you had kids, and you said you didn't. And he says, well, you can't be a real man unless you don't know what it's like to work. Unless you have children.
Oh, my
children.
God, I don't remember that.
Well, that
did
was
Coppola say that to me?
Well, I believe that's my recollection, because I thought, like, because I remember it, because you said it to me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it must have had something to do with the fact that it was a puppet show.
Yeah, yeah.
And he basically said, you know, well, you don't know what it's like to have responsibility, that what you extrapolated from it was that, you know, how can I, you know, if you don't have a responsibility to other people, you know, how do you really know what it's like to be an adult?
Yeah, that's very true. I think that's very true.
Yeah, well, that's what I remember.
I think I remember him saying something like that, yeah.
Well, I mean, I don't know why I would remember it and
you
wouldn't.
That's funny. Well, because that's sometimes you give people things in your life and they remember them and you don't.
Yeah, because I think it's very indicative of how you think.
There was a library that Alexander the Great built in Alexandria, sitting in Egypt.
Uh-huh.
And it had all the great Greek works of Greek literature and philosophy and art, everything.
Right.
And then when we became a Christian West world... They burned, the Christians burned everything.
Yeah.
And they burned that library down or whatever. I don't know. I could be wrong about all this. But we still have a little bit of Plato and Socrates.
Yeah.
Very little. There was a lot more.
Yeah.
Because the Muslims kept it. Because when the Muslims did their run of conquering the world, they kept stuff. They didn't burn other people's work.
Right.
They would integrate it and save it.
Right.
So we have all Greek... literature and philosophy and all that stuff exists because the Muslims held on to it while we were going through the Dark Ages and forgetting everything and letting this Jesus-y shit ruin everything.
Yeah.
And then when we came out of the haze, the Muslims were there saving it for us.
Yeah, and that was, you used that to sort of exemplify.
You remember this Coppola thing and I don't.
Yeah, this is very great about the way you think because like you have minor problems in your life and I always like, if it could be like, you know, I really have to stop eating ice cream. And then you go off on like, because I was reading the autobiography of Theodore Roosevelt. And you have this way of taking these, you know, global history of great movements to sort of like, you know, as wisdom, which I think goes back to this idea that, you know, when you have to parent yourself, you might as well.
Well,
draw
it's like what the Jews do. You know, the Jews. They keep their whole people's history together, and it keeps guiding them, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, no, I definitely think, I definitely like stories.
Yeah, and the one other thing I wanted to bring up before we go into the other great memory, there were two things that happened at the Chelsea apartment, I think, that were great, was at some point in the middle of that fucking mess, you decided you were going to play trumpet. and and you went out and bought a very expensive trumpet without any real plan in place to learn how to play trumpet. And you brought the trumpet home and you put it on the mantle and you jerked off. And after you jerked off, you realized that if you had just jerked off before, you wouldn't have bought the trumpet.
Yeah, no, it's worse than that.
What?
Because I went to Times Square to buy the trumpet. That's where all the music stores are.
Yeah.
I just wanted to buy a trumpet to learn how to play trumpet. Yeah. And I went into Sam Ash or one of those places. And there's all these, student trumpets.
Yeah.
For like, $100.
Yeah.
But I started going up to, there's a really nice one.
Yeah.
And the guy started showing me, here's like a nickel-plated, beautiful trumpet.
Yeah.
It's got a flawed bell because it was hurt, but they repaired it.
Yeah.
And it was like $1,400.
Yeah.
I didn't have any of that kind of money.
Yeah.
But I went to an ATM and I took out like everything I had in the bank.
Yeah.
And I bought this fucking $1,400 trumpet without having any ability or even, I'd never even blown into a trumpet before.
Yeah.
And then I was walking through Times Square with this fucking thing in my hand, just freaking out and feeling bad.
Yeah.
And I went and ducked into what they used to have then, those fucking porn plays, the peep shows.
Yeah.
Next thing I know, I'm in a peep show booth, those little upright coffins.
Yeah. Yeah.
Looking at a chick, a tired fucking Latvian girl probably, through the window of this peep show and jacking off.
Yeah.
And it's like a 2 by 2 foot room.
Yeah.
And I jerk off and I came on the trumpet case, which was standing between my legs.
Yeah.
And once I came and I looked at this cum on the trumpet case, on this beautiful, brass buckled trumpet case.
Yeah.
I realized if I had come to this peep show first, I could have saved $1,400. I wouldn't have the fucking trumpet now, which I never really learned how to play. Yeah. That was an important thing for me to realize that.
In what way?
Well, I went to a therapist for a while and he started dragging me through my past and I couldn't do it. It was exhausting. I couldn't do it. And I also didn't see an end to it.
Mm-hmm.
And I started saying to him, I don't want to do this anymore. Can you just give me some advice?
Yeah.
Can we just boil it down to how the fuck do I get out of my own way?
Yeah.
And he told me, all right, well, when you do things that you regret all the time, like eating bad food or jacking off in a weird, shameful situation you wish you hadn't, sexual compulsions, behavior, eating compulsions. He said, you're not the thing, the issue isn't the food or the sexual objects.
Yeah.
It's anxiety. You're having anxiety and you're doing these things to try to
feel better,
deal with your anxiety.
Right.
And maybe if you tell yourself that in the moment, it might help you. And that was an enormous help. I mean, that's sort of what I told myself with the trumpet, which is every time I'm starting to have like a thing that I'm not in control of.
Right.
Like, I want to buy a motorcycle. This happened the other day. I want to buy a fucking Triumph Bonneville motorcycle.
Yeah.
I have no business buying a motorcycle, but I poured over the website, started reading reviews of Triumphs and trying to talk myself into it's okay to spend $8,000 on a motorcycle. But I'm practiced now at stopping and going, why are you looking at, it's got nothing to do with motorcycles. You're anxious. Something's irritating you. And in just the act of doing that cuts you off of the sometimes.
Well, that helped me just now because that's when I realized that with myself that I'm not a depressive. But when I get anxious, I get overwhelmed and paralyzed.
Yeah.
And that, like, the only thing you can do is to feel better.
Jacking off is a great way to get rid of anxiety.
Oh, yeah, it is. Yeah, it's built in.
It's not sexual. And knowing that.
It's right. It's not sexual.
It's very helpful.
It is.
Very helpful to know this is just, I'm having a function of, there's something going on inside of me. It doesn't even have to be that it's deep-seated in my, fuck it. It's just anxiety. You're feeling bad.
Right.
Take a fucking breath.
Okay, well, that's part one of my conversation with my friend Louis C.K. We'll have part two on Thursday. I hope you're enjoying it. And there's a couple of things. I mentioned a lot of dates at the beginning. They're all up at WTFpod.com, at MarcMaron.com. But what I can't stress enough is get on the mailing list because I really am being diligent about that. And you'll get information about when I'm performing near you and also all the dates that are coming up. I would just like to be in touch with you like that. And please, if you can find it in your heart to donate a little money, we've got some nice new T-shirts. I'm printing up some new WTF T-shirts with a new logo. We got the cat T-shirts now. We've got several packages. If you do a $10 a month rolling donation, I'll send you a T-shirt. And some stickers, and a postcard. If you do a $250 one-time premium package donation, I'll send you the Cat T-shirt, the new WTF T-shirt, my three CDs, the special premium donor Best of WTF CDs, some stickers. I got a few books if you'd rather have books than CDs. And please support the show, because we are living on your generosity. And I appreciate you listening. Look forward to Louis Part 2. Let's talk about the moment where, because I don't know when it happened because of whatever our relationship is, but at some point, you know, creatively, you know, you were making these absurdist films and you were respected for that. And they were great. All of them are very great. But your stand-up was still at this place where you're like, I have a peach.
Yeah.
And then at some point, you know, and people, some people in the community were surprised by the transition, because you were really a uniquely poetic absurdist comic. And you got a lot of respect for that.
Right.
But then all of a sudden, something broke in you.
Yeah.
And you were all of a sudden doing, you know, personal revelation comedy. I mean, you were a guy that if an audience member, you know, interrupted you, you were like, I don't even know what to do with that.
Yeah.
You didn't even know how to do crowd work, because no. it was beyond you.
Yeah, the act I was doing was kind of meta. It was kind of absurdist comedy. I wasn't really functioning as a stand-up.
Yeah.
How you guys doing?
Yeah.
I wasn't that kind of guy.
Right. You were doing if anyone interrupts this process, you know,
I'm thrown off.
Yeah. Right.
This is fake.
Yeah. So what was the moment, if there were a series of moments that made you snap and get angry and realize that, you know, life is pummeling me, and this has to be relevant?
Well, I think it was, I guess it was having children. I guess having kids was a big revelation for me, because everything in my life that meant anything to me was work and stuff, you know, and
jerking off and ice cream and
yeah,
and,
I mean, that was like in this muddled outskirts of my life, this thing that I had to do because it was me patching together a personal life.
Yeah, but you were also you're a warrior in the sense that, you know, like there was a time where, you know, you and Attell and DePaulo, like you and Attell were battling for superiority, you know, in a fairly.
And he won that. He won that.
That round, yeah.
Yeah, he became the biggest comic in New York, and I just felt like I kept shrinking and shrinking and shrinking.
But it was a very conscious thing that there was. You guys were friends, and there's nothing wrong with healthy competition.
No.
And the way that you both saw each other. I had him on the show last night, and he was manic and brilliant, and you know, but he's a very different animal than you.
Totally different.
And the thing was is that there was this real sort of like, you know, leader of the pack shit going on.
Yeah.
And you've always had that the struggle to be recognized for being the best fucking comic, that all of a sudden now, you know, you have kids and your life is no longer just about, you know, executing your will as a comedic talent and being recognized. You're responsible for other people.
Yeah, definitely.
And that sort of must have imposed on your sense of narcissism.
Yeah.
To have that responsibility. And I think the struggle of that first special, which I think redefined you, was you struggling with the fact that you might have a problem, a competitive problem with your children.
Right, right.
They were an imposition on your life.
Yeah, I mean.
But you loved them.
Yes. Well, they were an imposition because I loved them.
Yeah.
If I didn't care about them, there wouldn't have been an issue.
You'd just be one of those dads. Yeah, I got kids.
Yeah.
I don't know what
I can't
doing.
Really spend much time with them, but they're there somewhere. I mean, like when you read about people, famous, great guys from the past, and their kids just were completely and utterly ignored by them.
And fucked up now.
And everybody just thinks that was a byproduct of how great that person was, and we all give them a pass for it. That's the way a lot of people think of that.
But I also remember a lot of this impetus about, you know, how you were going to handle kids and how you were going to break a pattern was that, you know, your father split.
Yeah, I wasn't going to do what my dad did. I also just, it was a huge thing for me. Yeah, because I always thought that every second of my life should be poured into work and doing what I want to do. And
stuff. Winning.
Yeah, and yet, well, I never looked at it that way. I've always been obsessed with the things that the projects that I'm doing.
Right.
I always get obsessed with them as work. I never really had this thought of, like, I want to be the best, or I want to be seen, or I want to be recognized. I just really wanted to keep being able to do what I do. I love the work.
Yeah.
And part of the work is showing it to an audience. I never would want to exist in a vacuum and not. To me, the whole point is bringing this shit to crowds and making them laugh.
Right.
But anyway, you know, I had seen a lot of like 60 Minutes episodes where they talk about a guy like Bill Parcells or whoever. And,
yeah.
And they he just look at how he's so manic and
yeah.
He's so amazing. And yeah. Then they talk to his wife and she always has this kind of smile and says, we just know that we don't see Bill from, you know, September 1st yeah. to February 15th.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's, you know, you make a deal with yourself that that's okay and I love him. And they always say, and then at the end of the episode, the Morley Safer says, they're divorced now.
Yeah.
So I always remember that and seeing the kids going, Dad loves football, you know, and not much else.
Yeah.
And I always thought that's really not okay. If you're going to have kids, you should have, you know, don't have kids if you're going to do that.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, I didn't, when I had my daughter, her mother had her in front of me, everything changed. I just fell in love with this kid. I just felt, I remember she was screaming in the delivery room. Really upset. She seemed particularly upset. I mean, kids are supposed to cry when they're born, but she seemed angry to me and upset. Like I expected, just oh, you know, when a kid's crying in the delivery room, everybody's smiling.
Yeah.
Ah, look at her cry. You know, but I was really upset for her.
Yeah.
And they put her on this little table and they're putting stuff around her. Sorry.
It's all right.
Unexpectedly emotional. It's not a story that I tell a lot, so.
It's all right, man.
Let me have some water. Water is good. It washes away your love for your children. So you can talk without a shaking voice. Yeah, they put her on this little table, yeah. And they're fucking jabbing shit into her, yeah. And they're just rough with her, and she's screaming, and her mother, it was a C-section, so her mom was being sewn up, her mom was just taken away.
Right.
And I'm like in the middle of this, I'm between her mother, like, do I care for, also, her mother is who I'd been caring for. She'd been pregnant for 9 months, and I'd been caring for her.
Yeah.
And it all had been about her, the mother. The thing that happens when you have a baby is, for the better part of a year, you live with pregnancy.
Right.
And it's all about that.
Right.
And then you sort of feel when the woman's in labor, you just think this is about getting this woman through this,
right?
And when it's done, we're going to go. That she and I are going to go home,
right?
You really don't. As much as you think you understand, you don't really understand that someone else.
You just know you got to go to the hospital.
You got to go to the hospital and get through this thing that we've been taking classes about. Yeah, we've been reading books about it.
Yeah.
I've been coping with her emotional instability and her volatile, you know, suddenly we're going to build a new kitchen. I got to go buy wood, you know, I mean, stuff like that. And she was really into her pregnancy and I was there with her.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you just don't know till you see the kid's face that there's somebody who's now going to be with you for the rest of your fucking life.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so I didn't know how that would feel. But when she came out, it wasn't about my feelings.
Yeah.
It was, this kid is scared shitless, and she's really angry of being taken out of her mom.
Yeah.
And I was pulled for 1 second. There's this woman that's been the center of all this.
Yeah.
She just got cut in fucking half in front of me.
Yeah.
They just made a hole in her belly and took this kid out. And she's being sewn up, and she's alone.
Yeah.
And this kid's over there, and she's alone, and I'm in the middle.
Yeah.
So I went to the kid.
Yeah.
And I got my head next to hers, and I said, she's screaming, purple face.
Yeah.
I said, it's okay, it's okay. You're going to be okay. It's all right. I'm here.
Yeah.
And she stopped screaming on a dime, turned and looked right at me.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, kids can't see an inch in front of them until they're like a couple weeks old.
Yeah.
But she turned her head and opened her eyes and looked at me and stopped crying.
Oh, my God.
And everybody, all these practiced people said, oh, my God, she heard you. One person said she heard you, and then one woman who I didn't know what was, I just heard a voice say, she knows who you are.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah.
And then somebody at that moment stuck a fucking pin in her foot or something and had blood and just screamed again. But I didn't understand that I had a role in this kid's life until that moment.
Right.
And so it became about this kid, and she changed everything. And one way that she changed it was I expected her to be unhappy. I figured my whole
in general,
Yeah, just because she lived in someone's belly and she was this, you know, living this perfect life. And then you're taken out to where your skin is raw and being hit by the atmosphere and you cough all the time. Yeah. And you just, what awful life. That's the way I always looked at it. Like, it's just terrible. And the moment you're born, you're coping.
Yeah. Right and out of the
just,
gate.
You must just be
this
awful.
Is it. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, and yeah. Shit and piss and just diapers and just what an awful life. But after that bout of crying, she was, you know, within an hour, she was breastfeeding and she was happy.
Yeah.
I watched her eat her first meal. And I watched her shit her first shit. Like, I saw the system start working right in front of me.
Right.
And she dealt with it beautifully.
Yeah.
And I was inspired by her.
Well, it's interesting
having a positive attitude about life.
Well, that moment where well, I think that happens when you primarily want to have control of your life and, you know, and the people in your life and to a certain degree and that you were there for your wife. And that moment of concern where you realize, like, there is this raw life in front of you.
Yeah.
And on some level, outside of you being the father, you really have no control.
No, I just had huge sympathy for this kid.
Right.
That was the main feeling that I had. And everything started to flow from that. And I also found out, I mean, I don't like babies as a human. Like, I'm not wired for that. And before I had kids, I was really worried about having kids because I don't like being around babies. I didn't like them. I didn't feel sympathy for babies in the past.
Yeah.
And I didn't know how I would get, I thought it would just be taxing. To be have someone screaming or crying, to not be allowed to things on paper that you know about being a parent. You don't sleep very much. They get you up in the middle of the night. I was like,
you knew all that.
Yeah, and I was like, I can't do that. Pregnancy gives you some training for that because your wife gets up in the middle of the night. She has to pee. She needs help.
Yeah.
Pregnancy is like a perfect training program for having a kid. It's the closest you can get anyway. But anyway, what I learned was that I could do it all. I didn't mind getting up. I didn't mind being bleary and unsleepy. I didn't mind her screaming and crying because I just had sympathy for her because I wanted her to be okay. So I found out that I'm a patient person. I didn't know any of this about myself. I'm a patient person that I had capacity for love, for giving love and affection that I didn't know that I had and receiving it, and that I was really interested in teaching her and talking to her and interacting with her, all this stuff that I never knew I had. So it made me, and all this stuff about my own anxiety about my life just went away because I didn't give a shit. I instantly knew that I'm going to get old and die, and I wasn't afraid of it anymore because it's about her now. It's about giving her a chance to be happy and have her own confidence in her own life. That's what it became about. But it was a struggle that I didn't give up without a fight, like you said, in the special. And it's I laugh at that special for different other reasons than other people. I laugh at it because I was such a young dad. I didn't – that shit's old school to me now. Your kid gets you up at night. You know, so what?
But I also think it represents the conflict of – it sounds to me what happened was you know, you've got to accept that, as I do, that we are and can be, you know, extraordinarily narcissistic. And we have those feelings that, like, you know, we create our world and, you know, we comment on our own brains, and you were primarily commenting on things that you imagined. And that at that moment, it seems, where you became emotional and in the moment where it really happened was that it just shattered your narcissism.
It also taught me to be a man. It did what Coppola said it would. It taught me to be a man because you can't fuck around when you have kids.
Right.
You can't afford to go into a depression. You can't afford to go eat yourself into a stupor and lay on the floor. You can't do it. You got the kid needs to be taken care of, and the kid needs to be supported. I suddenly had a reason to raise to earn money that was real.
And this whole thing is what really defined the next phase of your creativity.
Yeah,
because all these struggles are still real to you. You still eat ice cream, but now
I still
you
do
have
that stuff. But I've learned, and also I learned. I started to look at shit as a real man does. In other words, instead of going like, I'll have an idea when I have it, and fuck the fucking system, and the studios are assholes.
Yeah.
And, you know, why isn't I getting the gigs? All that kind of stuff. Waiting around, expecting shit to just happen. I couldn't do it anymore. I had to start going like, okay, what do you want to do? Make plans. Make actual plans.
Yeah.
And execute them. Have an idea of how you're going to do it. Approach it as a very important thing that you do, and it's your job. take it really seriously and be dedicated to it, not just in how you feel, but in what how you live your life.
You can't live like a child anymore.
Can't do it anymore.
Right.
And can't do it. So that's when I started doing that. And I looked at guys like Carlin and Chris Rock and building a thing from a whole hour from the ground up. How do you do it? There has to be a way. These other people did it. Maybe I can do it. I'd been doing the same fucking absurd 40 minutes. I could never get above 40.
Yeah.
I was doing the same absurdist, silly 40 minutes of stand-up for a good 15 fucking years.
Give or take 25 minutes.
Yeah, close to
20. Yeah, but no, I mean like...
Oh, give or take 20, 25 minutes. Yeah, that would kind of switch in and out, but it's the same heart, same backbone, and I hated it. I hated it. I hated what I was doing. I'd outgrown, but I didn't know how to do anything else.
Right. And then the gift of real life hits you in the head and
you
realize...
Yeah, I really have to actually try. I actually have to like to go up on stage and not be afraid of bombing, not because I'm so cool... But because it's my fucking job. It's my responsibility.
But also, I think...
And I need a future as a stand-up. I have a child.
Right. And also, I think you're probably not giving yourself credit for the fact that you're the evolution of your creativity. Because I think you've always been a poet in the sense that you struggle to understand large struggles that people live in their life. Mm-hmm. And that you have a way of focusing down and capturing moments... that are very specific. Like I brought up to you after I saw your Tonight Show thing, and this is when our relationship was a little strained. But there are moments to me that the moments I appreciate about your stand up, are not necessarily the end of the joke or the flow of the joke.
Right.
But it was just that one moment where on the airplane where the guy's crouched, go into the smile go ahead, and he's crouched in that horrible smile, and he said, "That's the last." Smile left in America? Is that the line?
Right, that's the last smile left in America.
Yeah, and I said, that's fucking great. And you were like, I didn't even do the whole bit.
Right.
It didn't matter that you were able to take what was fundamentally an absurd understanding of things and the way you created imaginary scenarios to sort of do your observational comedy and apply that same sense of poetry to real life struggles and conflicts. And it's always there.
Yeah.
So it's just an evolution of your creativity.
No, and I learned through this shit I did early on how to build jokes and how to make stuff work. Yeah. I mean, I think I still use the same fundamental skills that I had then, but I'm just applying them to something that people actually want to hear about for the first time, I think.
And I think that comics should know, if you're listening, and regular people, that the way you work now is that you literally let your old material die.
Yeah, I kill it every year. About every year.
Literally, like you force yourself, you say, like,
never do it again. Yeah.
And you hold to that.
Yeah, for the most part. I do. I've had a few shows where I've crossed myself and said sorry to whoever I'm supposed to say sorry to and did an old bit. But it's rare. This is the hardest time I've had so far doing that.
Well, what's this, your fifth hour?
This is, I mean, the number four went into the series. I did, Shameless was the first time I did that.
The first special was Shameless?
Shameless was I did a half hour for HBO before that.
Right, I remember
built
that.
From the ground up. That was...
But that was years ago.
30 minutes. No, not that one from back then.
Oh.
When I did Lucky Louie,
right.
The deal I made was a pilot and a half hour.
Oh, okay.
So I did a half hour, one night stand.
Right.
About the kids and stuff.
Yeah.
That was my first time.
Oh, that
time
was
doing
the
it.
Kids one. That was, but that broke you in the second wave of the Louie career.
That and Lucky Louie came out exactly at the same time.
Right.
And so that was the first time that I'd done a half hour. It was about 40 minutes, but it was boiled down to half an hour that I hadn't had material a year before.
Right.
That was the first time I'd done that.
Right.
And then Lucky Louie, we shot the series.
Yeah.
And we wrapped in March of 2005 or 6. I can't fucking remember. And we didn't go on the air till June. We had a huge chunk of year where I just was waiting to see if the show was a success.
Yeah.
So I went on the road because I wanted to do an hour. I had this big thing in my head about getting 1 hour done.
Yeah.
And it's the smartest thing in the world I ever did because my thought was if I get canceled, I'll have something to build on to keep my life going.
Right.
If I get renewed, I'm probably on the air for years.
Right.
I do believe if Lucky Louie had gone season 2, it would have gone season 10, whatever I wanted. It just needed to get over that one hump. So I thought if I got the show, I'm going to retire as a comedian.
Right.
So this is my last chance to do an hour.
Right.
Or the show's going downhill. Yeah. I got to be a stand-up.
Right.
And so I started from scratch and built an hour of stand-up on the road.
And that was the first hour special?
First time I did it.
And what was that special called?
Shameless.
Right.
And I did it. And Lucky Louie got canceled in September while I was in the middle of that. It's the smartest thing in the world I did because I became obsessed with that hour.
Yeah.
And I actually started thinking, I don't know if I want to go back to work because I was loving stand-up like I hadn't for years and years. Because every show was high stakes.
Yeah.
Every show meant something because it was building that thing. And every show was new material, so it was scary.
Yeah.
And to watch this stuff actually work, and I learned all this shit about developing stand-up, developing an hour. And then in September, they canceled the show. And I said, can I please have a fucking hour? And they felt bad, the people that I worked for at HBO, and they said yeah, and they gave me an hour.
And then Shameless?
And I shot that in November.
And then after that came All Chewed Up?
So, yeah, so after Shameless, I thought, I know how to do this now. I want to do it immediately again. And I immediately started, I threw away every minute of it. That's the first time I thought of that idea, which is don't ever do the shit again.
Yeah.
And so when I finished shooting Shameless, I decided I'm never telling those jokes again. Never. Mm. And I'm going to start a new hour. So I went on tour, and now I was doing theaters and starting to make little, because Shameless did very well for me. I started selling real tickets. So I was doing some clubs, some theaters, and I spent a year building Chewed Up and got that on film. Did that for Showtime.
And you premiered the film, right? Was that Chewed Up? Was that the film?
No, Chewed Up was just on Showtime. It was just a Showtime special.
And now, well, what's the movie?
The movie is then the next, after Chewed Up was done, I started working right away again on a new special.
Mm-hmm.
That one fucking got huge. That one became like, I was doing 2-hour shows in big theaters around the country without any material from Shameless or Chewed Up. And I had been doing nothing but stand-up since Lucky Louie.
Yeah.
Like, I'd been living as a professional comedian without any other TV job, nothing else, for the first time in my life.
Yeah.
I've always had some other gig since Conan.
Right.
And I was just so into stand-up. I was just breathing and living stand-up. And it was great because I had divorced.
Yeah.
And I was able to be with my kids for the early part of every week and then go do stand-up. It was like a perfect career companion to my home life.
And then you shot that as a film.
And then I had so much material, and also Shameless and Chewed Up were still on TV, so nobody wanted a new one from me.
Right.
And so I had this idea to do it as a feature film. And I went and shot it in Milwaukee and shot it.
A stand-up concert movie, which hasn't happened in years. No one's done it in years.
There's no need for them because there's HBO, but it's still an experience that I wanted to try to do.
And what's going on with that film?
It showed at Sundance, did really well there. And then we had one night where we showed it in 8 cities in theaters.
And how'd it go?
It sold out every show. And then we showed it again in New York City for 2 shows last night or night before. It's showing in Philadelphia, I think.
And you think you're going to get big distribution on it?
Well, no, we won't.
Right.
I mean, we Epics is going to show it starting this weekend, starting Saturday.
How do you get Epics?
I don't know. I don't have it. I don't have it. All I know is that they were willing to throw it on TV, and they were willing to throw it on without, because Comedy Central owns it. Comedy Central paid for it.
Yeah.
But Comedy Central's going to cut it down to, you know, 60 minutes from 90.
Right.
And they're going to bleep it, which I knew going in.
And Epix paid you some money?
Epix paid me some money. They gave a little to Comedy Central and some to me. And they threw it on. They're going to put it on, and people will be able to see it on Epix uncut. And they can also go to epixhd.com, I think, and they can download it as a whole piece.
Okay.
So it's going to be available as its own thing for a long time. So that was that hour. But that hour was, so that was number 3.
Yeah.
And then after I did that, I quickly got to number 4. I got to my 4th hour really quickly. And then I got the series.
Right.
And the series has stand-up in it.
Yeah.
So that 4th hour is cut in pieces. It's in the 13 episodes of Louie.
So now you're working on your 5th hour.
I got my 5th hour, which start this Friday in San Francisco, and that's, I've got the hour ready, but through the fall it'll get refined, and I'm taking that on tour, and it's going to be the next series.
Okay.
It's going to be next season. I wish I could do more specials, but yeah. I can't do it. I can't do a special and have the same material in the show. I think that's ripping people off. I don't want to do that.
Okay, well, see, that's a work ethic that no one has, and you do it without writers. No. I mean, you know, a lot of people work to the point, like, you know, there's a lot of guys, and I don't need to mention names, who everybody knows, that really haven't written their own jokes in 15 years.
Yeah, sure.
And, you know, they become a personality, they hire writers.
Yeah,
and
they become a refillable. They become a sort of just a rhythm that you can refill with any subject.
Well, people can write for you, and you choose not to do that.
Yeah, that doesn't seem fun to me to do that.
Right, and that's an amazing feat, and I think any comic would know that. Now, I don't want to just rush over Lucky Louie, but I think that what happened there, and we don't have to go into the politics of it, but I remember you dragging me, not dragging me, I was always happy to see what you made. No, I'm serious. You said, I want you to watch this pilot. So, you had the show at CBS, which wasn't right. That was Louie.
St. Louie was Saint the Louis, first right. pilot I did, yeah.
Yeah, and that didn't go, but that made sense that it didn't go on some level. It wasn't going to honor you anyways. And then
never
you did Lucky Louie, and then I remember you showed me the pilot, and the conceit of it was, once again, that it was very brilliant in the sense that you showed me this pilot, you explained to me, what it was. He said, look, what we're doing is we're doing the Honeymooners. That's what we're doing. And the set is the Honeymooners set. It is stripped down. We're doing, straight out, 1950s, 1960s television where the action takes place in almost it was almost like television like post-vaudeville where you're dealing with almost play sets.
Right.
And that was your idea, is that we're going to infuse a modern sensibility into a classic context. And that was the intellectual conceit of it. And it was like, and nothing that anybody had ever seen. And the rawness was like nothing anyone had ever seen. And the conceit, I think, ultimately, what happened was the conceit was lost. That the idea that we were doing the Honeymooners and that there was something, an intellectual approach to taking something, classic.
Right.
And updating it. I think some people were like, why didn't they make better sets?
Yeah, that's what some people said. And right. I remember being on the phone with Chris Albrecht, who ran HBO at the time, and gave me the show. And he was laughing about reviews that said, the sets are so poorly constructed.
Right.
And he said, why would we let that happen unless it was on purpose?
Right.
Like, do they really think that I'm reading... This is Chris Albrecht.
Yeah.
Does this reviewer really think I'm reading this and going, oh, God, we really should have put more money? I mean, look at what we do. Look at fucking The Sopranos heavy production they put in everything.
Yeah.
Why would we do that unless it was deliberate?
Right.
The reason I did it that way, I wasn't trying to go back to Honeymooners so much as I was trying to scale back what had happened to sitcoms that hadn't helped them.
Right.
Because I hated every sitcom on the air.
Right.
Even the good ones. Whatever. Seinfeld, right. Friends,
right.
Frasier.
Right.
I hated them because I didn't feel like I was watching anything that was really happening or even being... They were all shot on film, and they were all... I don't want to spend too much time on this because I could go on a long time. But I felt like the audience was being cheated by these shows.
Yeah.
And it wasn't only The Honeymooners. It was also All in the Family. Was
right.
For me, the thing was... That it used to be guys like performers like Jackie Gleason and what's his name? Fucking Carol.
Carol O'Connor.
Yeah, Carol O'Connor.
Yeah.
Were aware of their audience. They were. I remember seeing an interview with Jackie Gleason with a big long cigarette where he said, you can't do comedy without an audience because the audience tells you what to do. The audience tells you if it's funny. The audience tells you how long to sit with it. The audience tells you. How to say it.
Yeah.
And it's true when you watch The Honeymooners that he was totally measured by the crowd as far as his rhythm. And
yeah.
He would, when he got his laughs, he would live inside those laughs by walking around.
Right, right. Yeah, of course. Right.
He would milk like he would, you would hear a laugh dying.
Yeah.
And then he'd shoot a glance at the wife and the laugh would explode upward. And I love that kind of work. To me, that is a beauty. In playing an audience like an instrument.
I don't know what the demise was, and you can tell me, and I'm going to be honest with you. Do you think, because you're evolving into a very effective actor, do you think at the time that you did Lucky Louie that you were stifled by your acting ability?
Well, I didn't. I wish I'd done what Gleason did. You hear these stories that he never came to rehearsals.
Yeah.
Every cast member of that show that was ever interviewed tells that story. He didn't come to rehearsals. Every actor, every real TV actor really needs rehearsals in order to know what they're doing.
Yeah.
And everybody rehearsed without him.
Mm-hmm.
And then he would just come in and go, all right, what are we doing? And he'd know half his lines.
Yeah.
And he wouldn't know the blocking.
Yeah.
And they just learned how to work around that. I mean, they really were brilliant that they could do that.
Yeah.
They also recognized that he was the whole show.
Yeah.
And that even if he stumbled through a scene, he would save it.
Yeah.
And actually that stumbling is what made the scene's great because he knew he'd have to save it.
Yeah.
When you're given a script and a week of blocking and rehearsal and repetitive and over again,
yeah,
you just, all you got to do is do it.
Yeah, it kills the comedy.
Yeah, but when you are given a fucking, when you put yourself on a high wire, I'm on a TV show. And back then, everybody on the planet Earth watched The Honeymooners.
Yeah.
It wasn't like
right.
those yeah. who like HBO. It was like everybody watched. It was like 50 million people.
Yeah.
So he, in front of all those people, he'd be like, oh, okay, you could see him in some scenes, like, I'm not sure where I am or what's supposed to happen in this scene. I'm just going to do this. Bwah! And he would just be hilarious.
Yeah.
I wish I'd done that, because I have better instincts as a comedian than I do as an actor. And we rehearsed like a motherfucker. We rewrote. So we did everything I didn't want to do. When we started doing that show, I said to Mike Royce, who was my partner, we're not going to have a writer's room full of writers who are perfecting the scripts and rewriting every little line and like going pouring over it on a big screen where everybody chimes in.
Yeah.
We're not going to punch up everything and change out the fucking punchlines every take.
Yeah.
And we're not going to have this thing where we block and rehearse all this stuff. But we did it, and it just eased towards that because we had a staff of writers and because that's how people know how to do it.
Right.
If I could go back, I would have done it differently. I would have centralized the writing more, and I would have not rehearsed.
Yeah.
Honestly, I would have let them rehearse. The thing that changed it, though, was Pamela, who played my wife. She was like a comedy team with me. That was a huge revelation for me, to get laughs with a partner.
Right.
I had never done that before. That was a massive thing.
Right.
So, and Pamela came from traditional television, and she also said, you know, trust some of these people. Let them help you.
Yeah.
And I think that was smart.
But what was
Lucky Louie was harder than this series I'm doing now. It's just a huge amount of work. And you
what
also
was
have
the ultimate demise of it?
Well, a few things. I think the reason some people didn't like it is because what they had been fed in television didn't prepare them well for it. Everyone thought it was a laugh track. Everyone thought we put in fake laughs, and some people were really turned off by that.
So in the same way they didn't understand the context of the set,
yeah,
they
the
made
sets
assumptions.
Were the set was the set because I just didn't give a shit what the set looked like.
Right.
The idea was we're going to go back to when these shows were funny, because they hadn't been, to me, funny in a long
meant
time.
Doing it in front of real audience without amplifying the laughter.
Yeah, exactly. Putting an audience in front of the stage and letting their laughs be in the show.
And people didn't know better.
No, and actually,
so it was lost on them.
Yes, they just thought it was fake laughs and shitty sets
and
bad acting. Whereas it was, we were holding for laughs, which TV sitcoms are written by Harvard graduates who don't like audiences.
Yeah.
They don't like people.
Yeah.
They're not popular people.
Right.
And so they hate the idea that audiences can tell them whether something's funny or not.
Right.
So they've built a system where they shoot on a stage in front of an audience, but they ignore the audience.
Right.
And they feed them pizza. There's only 10 of them left when they finish shooting. Most big sitcoms don't have an audience now.
Right.
And they have a man called the Laugh Man, and he puts in the laughs.
Right.
And the laughs are short enough that the that the clippy dialogue can continue.
Right.
Jennifer Aniston never looks aware of the audience when she's supposed to be performing in front of an audience.
Yeah.
On Friends, that's how old I am.
Yeah.
But we had to hold for laughs, and it was a mess, but it was supposed to be. But most people thought, and we even had a thing like in Happy Days, Lucky Louie was taped before a live audience.
Right.
We said that before every show.
Yeah.
And everyone would still say it's canned laughter. I even read something on a website where somebody said they should have told people that it was taped before a live audience. That was a big mistake. We did.
Yeah.
But people remember what they... Anyway, that's why people didn't like it, I think. Other people just didn't like it because nothing is perfect. A lot of people hate everything.
Right.
But we went off the air because HBO was changing. I mean, everybody that's there now that wasn't there when I was there.
Right. It was just one of those.
We got great ratings.
Yeah.
We got great ratings.
It was a great show. But now this is the miracle. This is the perfect storm is where we're at now. And
yep.
You've got a deal now that people are, that comics are now telling their managers. So
I want the Louis C.K.
deal. Give me the Louis C.K.
deal. Yeah,
that's
what everybody says,
Because you've got all these different cable outlets. You aligned yourself with FX who basically said, like, here's some money. You said, look, don't pay me a salary. Just give me this money and I'll make these things.
Yeah.
And they trusted you enough. You had a big enough track record. You're a capable director. You're a capable comedy writer. You're a capable showrunner. You're a capable performer. And you're a stand-up. And they trusted you with that. You're like, it's like fucking, it's like Orson Welles.
Yeah.
Just give the, and the money was nothing, right? I mean, not in the sense that like it was obviously money, but in the context of what money they throw away.
Yes.
On bigger,
way more money. Yeah.
Right. And so you took this all on, and the amazing thing about what's happening now with this show, and you know, I watch it, and I love it, and I love you. Yeah, but yeah, but sometimes my resentment gets in the way. But I do a joke on stage now. I actually say I don't know when my friend's success is going to seem like anything but an attack on me. I don't, and I say like I don't know why Louis had to call his show "Fuck You, Marc Maron," but that's what comes up on my television. But the thing is what I know about you is like people are like I don't, you know, it's confusing to them sometimes because there's not a singular narrative,
right?
It's got a feeling, a raw feeling that people are like I don't know how to react to the show.
Yeah.
But what I know is that this is Louis C.K. investing all his talents of everything he's done and all his life experiencing doing exactly what he wants to do.
Yes, that is what it is. Yeah.
And the amazing thing is that you're making short films,
yeah.
You're doing stand-up, you're constructing narratives as they occur to you from your life experience. And also the amazing thing is your loyalty to the crew that you have worked with on your films throughout your entire career. That's more than the writers or anything else, because you're writing all these yourself, that your loyalty was to your cinematographer, to your set deck, and to the point of the way you're lettering the credit letter.
My old Cooper Black lettering, yeah.
Right. So this is you being a filmmaker.
Yes.
More than anything else, and I don't know if people really understand that.
Yeah, some of them do, some of them don't, and it doesn't really matter.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, this has been a crazy dream, this thing. It's been amazing.
And it's successful.
Yeah,
they're
going to
do
doing another season, yeah.
How many episodes?
13.
Now, how the fuck are you going to do that yourself?
Keep doing it? Well, I did it once, and I do ask myself that every day right now, and I'm already working on the writing. I'm trying to get the ideas. I don't want to take a step down from what I just did. I want to develop it. I want to get better. I think anything you do should be better than anything you did before. I mean, that to me is a guiding principle.
Fine, but how
everything
are you
going
to do it
better.
Physically?
Well, I just did it. I mean, I learned from just doing it. In other words...
Because a guy in your position now, like, why wouldn't you bring in writers?
Because that's not how it worked the first time. That would change everything. If I brought in a writing staff, it would change everything. The show wouldn't be good anymore. I mean, it wouldn't be what it is. Good or bad, whatever, but it wouldn't be what it is. So, I mean, I did it. I did one season. It was hard. It was really hard.
Yeah.
But you did it. Yeah, and I could only get better at it. Also... I had to do it without knowing how I was going to do it. Now I know how I pulled it off the first time.
A system is in place. You out of necessity.
I have a company that we made. We had to do a huge amount of stuff that we never have to do again.
Right.
We had to find offices. Some shit that's just simple. But we had to get decide what system we were shooting on. We had to build a crew. We had to hire a bunch of people. Find a good workflow. We had to do, get fucking permits and a relationship with the state of New York and the city of New York, and all that. We had to bang out a union contract, all this stuff. We had to do all those things, and that was an enormous amount of work on top of, because I'm the head of the show, and everything comes back to me, even the union contracts and shit like that. So all that shit's done now. Now, and we had to, it started with a pilot, not knowing what the show was going to be about.
Yeah.
So all that's done now, and I know how to do it. I mean, I edit the whole show. I write and edit the whole show on my MacBook Pro on a 13-inch. I didn't even use a 15-inch, because let alone a 17, because I just like the intimacy of the little machine.
I
edited every episode on my little MacBook Pro.
Do you remember when you were editing Tomorrow Night on an Avid?
Yes.
The process it took to transmit, to put it from film.
Yes. To
onto
go to
the
an
computer,
Avid.
And then
huge.
like there was one Avid in the city.
That's right. No, Doug Abel, who's editing this show. I edit some episodes. He edited some episodes, but because I love editing. But Doug is my guy, and he edited.
And
all
your cinematographer is
Paul Kessner, who I've been working with since I was fucking 22 years old.
And your set deck is Amy Silver.
My production designer is Amy Silver.
Yeah, who you've been working with forever.
Forever. since Caesar Salad, my first short film that you were in,
yeah.
that you got cut out of.
I did cut out everything. I play guitar on the soundtrack.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. You did.
Was that Tomorrow Night or Caesar Salad?
Caesar Salad.
Okay.
But, yeah, I've been working with these people forever. And that's why I knew I could do it. I mean, when I went to FX, I had... you know, everybody wants the Louis C.K. deal, but it's not gonna be so easy for everybody.
Well, no, because no one can. This is what I'm saying: is it's that same thing. Is you got a comic? It's like, let me do that. Who the fuck can do that?
Well,
I'm exhausted listening to your process.
A lot of it is because of technical knowledge.
No, you're right.
It's because I took that fucking AV class in junior high school and learned how to fix
a computer.
That's why. It's because I learned how to fix a fucking overhead projector. And I learned how to rewire shit and fix it.
Yeah.
That's why I know how to do this stuff. Because when I was in high school, I got an internship at a local access cable TV station, and they had remote deck and camera setups.
Yeah,
and they had editing bays, and the only reason they don't let you use shit in those places is because you might break it. They're just worried that you'll break it. It costs money.
Yeah.
But I fixed that shit. Like, I became this techie kid. I was like this little nerdy kid who would fix the fucking cameras.
Yeah.
So certainly they trusted me with it. Like,
yeah.
I had the keys to every room in that fucking station.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't even tell anybody. I would just take the shit out.
Yeah.
And I would shoot my own little videos.
Yeah.
And I'd edit them when nobody was using the editing bay. I taught myself how to do everything.
Yeah, that's
my phone.
That's
sorry.
Right. No problem.
So... that's what always gave me the license to do this stuff. And I know everything about filmmaking, shooting on, you know, we shoot on the Red, which is a high-tech, really difficult camera to use.
Yeah.
It breaks a lot. It fucks up. We use these huge Master Prime lenses, which are the kind of lenses they shoot movies on. They're enormously expensive. It's one of the biggest line items in our... we spend more on lenses than we do on anything else.
And it's interesting because your vision as a filmmaker and Paul's vision with you as a cinematographer, when you watch it, there's some parts of it where you're thinking, like, you know, it doesn't look, you know, the way you shoot is not unlike Lucky Louie, that it's pretty stripped down. You're not using a lot of effects.
Sometimes. I mean, some shows, some of the episodes are shot like a handheld, let's just grab this moment. And some of them are shot like, no, we're using we're opening the lens all the way up. We have to measure everything. You know,
right,
like the religion episode is shot very carefully.
But the tone of it is still pretty raw.
Oh, yeah.
On purpose.
Yeah, definitely.
And the great thing about it is, like, you know, there's a signature moment that is, you know, completely your, you know, comedic vision. All of it to me is that, you know, the scene where you're having the troubled date with Chelsea Peretti and she gets into a helicopter. This is Louis at his best. This is Louis. You know, as Francis Ford Coppola in Heart of Darkness, we're like, I need a helicopter for this one punchline.
Yeah.
This punchline requires we rent a helicopter
exactly.
and clear airspace.
Yes.
And you committed to that.
Yeah, exactly. No, we had people working on walkie-talkies and all kinds of stuff. Yes, we had to clear East Side Manhattan airspace to take a helicopter off a bunch of times.
For a punchline.
Yeah, for a punchline that most people, a huge amount of people I knew wouldn't like because it's so absurd.
But that's
a lot of people say it's not. It took me out of it. I don't care. I liked it. Those things like the helicopter exist for two reasons. One is because just I like it, and also I did like. I get off on squeezing a lot out of very little money, and the budget for this show was tiny, and I wanted to show FX that I could do a lot with money. And there's a helicopter. There's 20 limousines. Which was a huge expense. There's no company in New York that has 20 limousines. We had to pull together and harmonize like five limo companies because they all had to be beautiful limousines. We didn't want any like Carmel car cracked windows.
This is for the bus scene?
This is the scene where
the school bus?
Yeah, I get all the kids in the school bus. And we had a fucking school bus that hit the fucking, you know, we had to create this moment where it gets a fucking flat tire in a school bus is a huge production undertaking.
Yeah.
But so I wanted them to really see that, Jesus Christ, this is really a show. It's not just a bunch of, you know, alt comedy kids acting awkward on a street corner.
Yeah.
And that the show continues to do stuff like that, throwing the bottle out the window and destroying a car. I love
that,
doing stuff like that.
That moment, that's one of those moments where not unlike the Last Mile in America, where I'm like, that comes out of nowhere but makes complete sense.
Yes, like, it's exactly what needed to happen.
Yeah.
And it's hard to defend moments like that when you're producing them.
Right.
Because Blair Briard, who's she's the executive producer of the show, and she's the person who makes everything happen.
Yeah.
She's the most enabling and incredible producer I've ever known. She produced Pootie Tang. That's where we met.
Yeah.
She was like, do we have to? I mean, it's such a stupid, silly thing. But it she kept saying to me, I just want you to be aware that the bottle on the window thing, you can do it, but it's causing huge problems. The building doesn't want us to throw it out the window. It's a permit problem. It may be a safety issue. And the cost is enormous. And the effects people said it can't be done the way you want it to be seen. They said you're going to have to get a zip line and a bunch of squibs and blow up the car. And I just kept saying it has to be. She said, does it have to be that? Can you come up with something? Because it's not an important plot point.
It's the most important thing.
To me, it was. That's the thing. Is to defend absurdity in production.
Yeah.
When it's expensive, is you just have to go. You have to have the credibility to say, I'm very sorry. And also, because I know production and I know technical shit,
yeah,
I solved all those problems because I know how to do it. So I come up with ways.
But the absurdity injected in those moments where a guy makes a decision like that, where he hasn't done drugs a lot and he's in this situation that's clearly chaotic, it's outside of his life experience, that how is that scene going to culminate in any other way other than a moment where you're like, this is beyond anything I understand.
It had to be. It had to be. It was really important. No, and one way that we do that stuff, it's all brass tacks, logistics. The great thing about
The vision. You have a vision. How do you make the vision?
Blair needs to believe me that it's important. And then it starts happening. And like the helicopter. I said to her, can you get me a helicopter? Like, that was one of the first things I said to her when I got the pilot.
Yeah.
I said, I got a pilot. I want you to produce it. Start working on a helicopter right now, an affordable helicopter. And we shot all this stuff, and she would once in a while report to me, I'm not finding a helicopter yet. Start thinking of an alternate. And I'd say to her, there isn't an alternate. Get a helicopter. And she'd keep working on it and working on it. And then she found this dude who he's a new helicopter guy.
Yeah.
He's the new guy in town. There used to be one helicopter guy. Yeah. This guy's new. He's competitive. He wants to get in the business.
Yeah.
And he had one day. She kept trying to drive his price down. It's fucking tens of thousands of dollars for helicopters.
Right.
She kept driving his price down. She couldn't get it low enough. And then one day, but because she bothered him enough and kept being tenacious, one day he said, look, I'm doing something for Comedy Central for some other show. I got to gas up and go anyway. I can give you an hour. So on his way to something else, he shot our thing. And we got it for fucking dirt cheap because she has relationships with all these people. That's why I knew I could do this show, because I had Blair and because I had Paul. Because Paul can pull together natural light, a few other lights, and he can work with really, really. I do everything the hardest possible way. There's no zoom lenses on my show. They're all fixed focal lenses, which means you have to change the lens at almost every shot.
Right.
It's an enormous amount of work.
Right.
And I knew that Paul could do it. I knew that Amy can take a restaurant and make it into four restaurants.
Right.
That kind of shit. So,
well, the amazing thing is that you do these things that are, you know, founded in your absurd vision and reveal your personal life. And then also, you know, sometimes you choose to do a narrative about bullies, which is very heartfelt. And the relationship with your kids and even with Pamela, who you've worked with before in the park, that, you know, that what you're creating is a real human struggle and real deep comedy. And it's completely honest to your vision, and you can do whatever you want with it. And I think that people are really taking to it, and it's successful. And the people that get it and are willing to write it, I think you're changing the tone of how television can be made. And I'm very proud of you, and I'm excited for your success.
Thank you, man.
And it's great to see you.
Yeah, you too.
And I'm glad we had this talk.
Yeah, you know, it's when you know somebody for a long time, it's a very valuable thing.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
I mean, we were best friends for a long time.
I know.
Long, long time.
I know. Well,
hard. There's times where it's hard to be your friend's friend.
I know, but I don't have them. I don't. It's not like I have new friends.
It's not like I was replaced by anybody.
No,
that would feel worse.
No, I'm still the same guy in a lot of ways.
Well, look, I give you, and you don't have to put this in the podcast if you don't want to. But what I would say, as far as trying to stay friends with somebody that you have a hard time thinking about what they're doing against what you're doing, is focus on them needing a friend.
Yeah.
It takes a good friend to stay with you in hard times.
Yeah.
It takes a good friend to stay with you in good times. Everybody needs support. Yeah. Everybody does.
Yeah.
So you're letting me down. If you see me doing something and you have a hard time coming to terms with it because you're feeling about your own life, what's really happening is you're letting me down as a friend. You're being a shitty friend by being jealous.
Okay.
So think about the other person. Well, think about what they might need.
I
could have used you. I could have used you. I got divorced. I got a show canceled. You know, I had some tough times. I could have used a friend.
But you didn't.
During those times that were making you jealous, I was struggling. I was having a hard time. But doing the Louis show was really hard. Trying to keep my family together was hard.
But the thing is that in the way our friendship always operated, it was not that I was kept up to date in the day-to-day things. It wasn't a day-to-day call that we had. But it seemed that most of the time, the thing that made our friendship so deep and so strong was that when we did talk, we made each other feel better.
No, it's true. But you shut me out. You shut me out because you were having a hard time.
Okay. And, well, I apologize again.
Well, I apologize to you because I did it to you probably out of resentment. Ignored your emails because you ignored my phone calls back when there was no email.
Can we get back on track or what?
Yeah, I think we can.
Because you understand me, and not a lot of people do. And the one thing that, and even when I tell stories about it, it's just that, you always, are able to, even in your weird way, and even if I thought you weren't listening, even when you did pick up what I was saying, that you were able to, give me a great deal of relief, fairly quickly, and I miss that.
Well, we understand each other's flaws very well,
because
we share some,
yeah,
and we've known each other long enough to understand them, so that's why we're able to look at each other, tell each other about moments that we don't want to tell anybody else.
Yeah.
And to be able to say, have the other person go, yeah, I get it, instead of going, oh my God, why did you do that? Or
yeah, the only time I did
get
that,
it, well, don't be stupid, do this instead, or whatever. That happens.
And the only time I said, oh my God, was when I realized that I had missed, so much of your life, and I felt horrible about it.
You know, what's funny is I did the same thing when you got divorced the first time. I got mad at you.
Yeah.
And I know now why, because I was married, and I didn't want you to get out.
Yeah.
it's hard. I mean, because being divorced, it has changed my relationship to a lot of people that are married that I knew before.
Yeah.
It just changes things. People look at you differently. So.
Well, I love you, man. Let's just try to fucking
same
be
here,
better, man. Better friends.
Okay.
Well, that's it. I'm glad that Louis and I are friends. I will have you know that I have emailed him a few times since we had the conversation. I've not heard back. But I did call him once late at night, and he answered. And I didn't have a lot to say, but I was happy he answered. So that's where that is. I had a great time talking to him. Hey, folks, if you didn't get this news before, there's a phone app available, a WTF iPhone app. You can get it if you search iTunes, WTF, Marc Maron. I hear it's fun. I don't have an iPhone, but I hear it's fun. And please go to WTFpod.com and donate a few shekels. American shekels will be fine. Get on the mailing list because I'm doing that. You can see what else is going on over there. We got the new T-shirts. I've got a new design coming up too, a new WTF shirt along with the cat shirt. So that's all happening. Oh, yeah, great shows coming up on the horizon. I've been doing a lot of interviewing, talking to a lot of people. Looking forward to sharing with you my conversations with people like Ira Glass, Sarah Silverman, Aziz Ansari, Paul Scheer. Man, Janine Garofalo was here. Whew. There's more. All right. Talk to you next week.